Greetings again today in the name of Jesus Christ, our wonderful Lord and Savior. Good to see you here in God's house today. We welcome every one of you. We welcome our visitors. We appreciate you coming to Northside today. And you that's listening out in the radio listening audience, we most certainly appreciate you tuning in to the Northside Baptist Church Hour that's coming to you live right from the auditorium of the Northside Baptist Church here in Athens, Georgia. Now, this is Preacher Edward speaking. We're hoping during the hour coming up we can be a real inspiration to everyone. And we'll certainly appreciate you in the radio listening audience calling a friend, having them to tune in and get this hour. I do believe we can be an inspiration to them. And the singing and the message will be on tape number 266. Tape number 266. We'll have the singing, the music, and the message. Now, per adventure, you in the radio listed audience doesn't get the complete message today. If I can't get stopped by dead 12 o'clock, then it will be on the cassette tape. You can write in and get the tape if you want to get the closing out of the message, if I don't get it all on the air. And remember, this will be a series on the book of Ruth. It'll be tape number 5, message number 5. On the book of Ruth. Take your Bible and turn to the book of Ruth, will you please? Page 316 in the original Schofield Reference Bible. Now, if you're not getting the daily broadcast, if you tune into the station where you're now listening, the big giant station WNGC here in Athens, you can get the daily broadcast at 12 o'clock noon. If you're not getting it, tune in and get it. We want to be a blessing to you. We're making a study of the book of Acts on our daily broadcast. We're having a wonderful time. I hope many of you are getting it. If not, I hope you will. I want you to pray for me. I want you to write to me. This is a faith ministry. And I depend entirely upon you that love the Lord to help me keep this program on the air. This is a home mission work. I've been on the air daily now in my 39th year. From the classic city of Athens, Georgia, preaching on the radio every day for 39 years, in my 39th year. It's not a fly-by-night ministry. And so when you support this ministry, you're supporting a worthy cause. May God bless you. My mailing address is Virgil Edwards, Post Office Box 501, Athens, Georgia, 30603 is the zip code number. In the book of Ruth, chapter 2, beginning with verse 8. Then said Boaz unto Ruth, Hearest thou my daughter? Notice that Boaz now is calling Ruth his daughter, not the Moabitess, but my daughter, he said. Go not to glean in another field, neither go from hence, but abide here by my maidens. Let thine eyes be on the field that they do reap, and go thou after them. Have not I charged the young men that they shall not touch thee? And when thou art athirst, go unto the vessels, and drink of that which the young men have drawn. Then she fell on her face, and bowed herself to the ground, and said unto him, Why have I found grace in thine eyes, that thou shouldest take knowledge of me, seeing I am a stranger? And Boaz answered and said unto her, It hath fully been showed me all that thou hast done unto thy mother-in-law since the death of thine husband, and how thou hast left thy father and thy mother, and the land of thy nativity, and art come unto people which thou knowest not hitherto. The Lord recompense thy work, and a full reward be given thee of the Lord God of Israel, under whose wings thou art come to trust. Now that's as far as I'm reading this morning. And if I go further in the chapter, you can reread it and it'll be a blessing to you. Now we saw much in chapter 1. We saw what and she comes back to the country, Bethlehem, Judea, there in God's land, where God had blessed, where God had poured his blessings out upon those people, and where that they had disobeyed God and going down into the land of Moab. But when they came back in the time of barley harvest. We saw where this speaks of new beginning, or speaks of revival. And then we saw Ruth as a beautiful type of a sinner being saved, and also a type of the church of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ.
Now when they came back to the land of Bethlehem, Judah, they met a man by the name of Boaz. Now Boaz is a man of strength. He's a man of wealth. And he's man number seven. Remember, six went down. There were six down there in Moab. And two came out, and they meet number seven, of course, which is the number of completeness. And this man Boaz speaks of the fullness of strength and speaks of wealth. He's a wealthy man. Now, I want us to notice today that Boaz discovers Ruth. In verse 5, you find then said Boaz unto his servant that was set over his reapers, whose damsel is this? Now, he comes into the field, and there he discovers Ruth gleaning there in his field. He's deeply concerned about that, of course, and he wants to know who this damsel is. Now, of course, the reapers may have overlooked her. They may have failed to see the real significance in her, as Boaz would see later. And they probably just kind of ignored her because she was working there in the field, as she was reaping or picking up, rather, gleanings from the ground, the grain that had been dropped there on the field. Now, the reapers overlooked her, but Boaz comes to the field. He glances over his men there in the field and the maidens working there, and he greets his laborers. We find in verse 4, and Boaz came from Bethlehem and said unto the reapers, the Lord be with thee. They answered him, the Lord bless thee. This would be the way, of course, that they'll greet each other during the millennium. Now, it would be wonderful if today that the laborers and the people, the workers and the people that's serving those that's in charge of the field, of the machine shop or wherever they're working, would greet each other in this manner. But you don't usually find that today. You find the laborers and those that own the field or the situation maybe not greeting each other in this manner each time they meet one another when they come in to work, the employer or the employees. But we find here the employer said, the Lord bless thee. And they said, the Lord be with thee. The employee said, the Lord be with thee. That's a wonderful way for an employer to meet, of course, the laborers, the employees that's laboring in his field. I'm afraid in many of our workshops today and factories and various places, you have what you call the pencil brain employers. That is, they go to college and they learn how to run the machinery by the way of reading books and being taught there in the college room. And when they come to the plant where the practical work is being done, they have never done any real practical work. And in a pragmatic way, they really don't understand it. And then many times they figure out how that the laborer can put in more, get more productive out of what he's doing, and of course gain more for them, and they figure that out by pencil and not by actual experience. But that person that's been on the job all the time, he's been doing the work, he's had the experience, and he knows what he can do. And many times the employee does get overloaded because of some fella that knows it all by pencil and by brains, knows nothing about it from a pragmatic viewpoint. But he comes on the scene, and he said, now, the Lord bless thee. And they said, the Lord bless thee. And then as he glances over the field, he sees his employees. He noticed an unusual person there. He sees Ruth. He sees Ruth the Moabitess, and she's laboring there among the laborers. And, of course, she's a stranger. And he was expecting, evidently, to see her in the field. And he sees her, and she's working there in the field. Now, I want you to notice something, would you please? After he sees her, remember that he's a type of Christ, and Christ sees all people. He sees you as a sinner. He sees you as a saint, and he knows all about you. And notice the unnamed servant here in the field. And this unnamed servant is a type of the Holy Spirit. Now, in verse 5, then said Boaz unto his servant, that was over the reapers, whose damsel is this? Now, that was a man employed in the field in charge of the other laborers. And he was the unnamed servant. He's a type of the Holy Spirit. Now, the Holy Spirit doesn't brag on himself. The Holy Spirit brags on Jesus. The Holy Spirit exalts the Lord Jesus Christ. He doesn't brag on himself. And you must remember that. Now, here is an unnamed servant, which is a type of the Holy Spirit. Now, as we look back over the scriptures, we can find in the Word of God, there's other unnamed servants in the Bible, which you find to be a beautiful type of the Holy Spirit. We find back in the days of Abraham. Abraham had an unnamed servant. If you read in Genesis chapter 24, that Abraham sends his unnamed servant there to secure a bride for Isaac. Now, Isaac was of age, and God had promised to bless Abraham's descendants through Isaac. And so Abraham knew it was time for his son to receive a bride. And so he calls his unnamed servant to send him back for the bride of Isaac. Now, this unnamed servant, of course, is a type of the Holy Spirit. You must keep that in mind. And, of course, he's to be sent back to the land where Abraham came from. And Abraham said, I don't want my son Isaac to marry a woman here among the heathen, among the people here in Canaan. I want him to marry someone back among our people. And so he's to send this unnamed servant back to the land he came from to marry some of their people back there. Now, it's never God's plan and God's way for a person that's saved to marry an unsaved person. That's not the plan of God. The Bible plainly said that believers should not be unyoked together with unbelievers. 2 Corinthians chapter 6 tells you that. And so if you're a child of God and you're wanting a companion and you're seeking someone to marry, then remember, marry another believer. Don't marry an unbeliever. Now you're called in the Bible as a child of God if you're saved. And in the Bible many times the sinner is called a child of Satan. So if you marry a child of Satan, then the devil will be your father-in-law. You're headed for trouble. And if you marry a child of God, God is your father. You must remember that if you're a child of God. And so he said, I want him to go back to our people. Oh, you may say, Preacher Edwards, I'm going with a young boy and he's not saved. And I think maybe I can win him to God after we get married. No, you can't. Chances are he'll turn you away from God and away from your church and away from the fellowship of God's people. Don't take any chances on that. If he's not willing to settle down, if he's not willing to get married, if he's not willing to do that which is right, if he's not willing to get saved, then you have no business marrying that unsaved person. He's not a fit companion for you. If he means business or if she means business, they would get saved, settle down, and be willing to do that which is right. Now, if they're not willing to do that, then, of course, they could not make you a good companion. Don't kid yourself. They just won't do it. It's never right for a believer to marry an unbeliever. So you must keep that in mind. And then we find that Abraham said to his servant, I want you to go back to our country, which he did. And he said, how will I know what woman to bring back? Abraham said, the angel of the Lord will go with you, and he'll direct you. And then the servant takes his camels and, of course, gifts from Abraham, and he goes back toward there the Chaldees, there to find a bride for Isaac. And he goes on his way, and he knows whenever he arrived on the scene, he came to a well, and he knew that the women come to draw water late in the evening, and he was at the right spot, the right territory. But now how would he know the right woman? And he prays. He says, now, Lord, the woman that comes to draw water, and if she offers to give me a drink of water and the camels, then that would be the right woman. And so he kneels down there at the well, and the camels kneel down, and they wait. It wasn't long until the servant saw someone coming, and that someone was a beautiful Rebecca. She's coming to draw water, to get water, to carry back to their tent, or whatever kind of building they were living in. And so she comes to the well, and she notices the stranger. She notices Abraham's servant. She doesn't know who he is, but she offers to give him water, as she offers then to give water for the camels, and that she did. And then the servant knew, without a shadow of a doubt, that this was the woman for his master's son, Isaac. And so he tells her who he is, and he gives her bracelets for her hands, earrings for her ears, And then she goes back with him, carries him back to meet her people. He's introduced to her people, and they begin to talk about the matter. And he tells a story how that Abraham sent him secure a bride for Isaac, who God is to bless with many descendants. And so she wants to go. They ask her a question, are you willing to go with this man? And she says, I am willing to go. Now her brother want him to remain there 10 days yet. Now he's a type of the law, type of the flesh, and he wants to hinder. But they said, we must go. And so the servant takes up the bride-to-be, Rebekah and her maid. And on the way they go, riding those camels back across the desert, some 500 miles. All the way across that desert, this unnamed servant is telling Rebekah about Isaac. He is telling her about Abraham. He's telling her about the wealth of Abraham. And he's bragging on Isaac and Abraham all the way across the desert. He's not bragging on himself. He's not trying to make a great impression for himself. He's bragging on his master. Now that's exactly what the Holy Spirit does. The Holy Spirit brags on Jesus. He doesn't brag on himself. He brags on the Lord Jesus Christ, our wonderful Lord and Savior. And so he travels across the desert. And finally he arrives on the scene, and there comes a handsome man out in the field late in the evening. And lo and behold, he sees the camels coming. And then Rebekah lights off the camel. She goes to meet the man she's to marry. She marries that man, enters into Abraham's tent. And so there we find that the unnamed servant secured a bride for Isaac, just like the Holy Spirit is securing a bride for Jesus today. He's calling out a people for the name of Christ, and every soul that's saved will become part of that bride. Now keep that in mind. Then we find in the Bible another unnamed servant. The Bible tells us in the book of Genesis chapter 43 and verse 16, there you have an unnamed servant in the household of Joseph. The Bible said when Joseph saw Benjamin with them, he said to the ruler of his house, bring these men home and slay and make ready for these men shall dine with me at noon. So here we find Joseph's brethren that had come down to get more grain. And of course they didn't know Joseph. He recognized them. And then he made himself known unto them. And he tells the unnamed servant, you bring these my brethren in to dine with me at my table today. And the unnamed servant did that. That's a type of the Holy Spirit bringing the church to the marriage supper of the Lamb to sit down at the table with the Lord Jesus Christ. This unnamed servant did that very thing. He brought those men in, the brethren of Joseph. Now the brethren of Joseph will receive the Lord Jesus Christ at the end of the tribulation period. Yes, at the end of Jacob's trouble, the nation of Israel will turn back to God, and they will sit down at the table, as it were, with God, enter into the millennium, that to reign on the earth and live in the millennium according to the word of God. So remember, this unnamed servant here in the household of Joseph brings his brethren into the dining hall. What a beautiful type of the Holy Spirit as to what he's doing today and what he shall do in the future. Joseph was a great man of God. The only two men in the Bible, outstanding characters that you find that do not have any sin recorded against them, and that's Joseph and Daniel. That doesn't mean they were perfect by any means, but it does mean that they had no sin recorded against them. They were good, clean-cut young men. Joseph was a great man. Joseph also is a type of Jesus. The Holy Spirit does not brag on himself. He brags on the Lord Jesus Christ. Then let's notice something else. We find here that Boaz really cares for Ruth. He says, let her glean among the sheaves in verse 7. Let her glean in the place where she can find much grain upon the ground. Let her glean where it'll be easy for her to find what she needs. That's just like the Lord Jesus in regard to the church, in regard to his children. God wants you to glean around the sheaves. And you can glean around the sheaves if you'll obey the Lord. And then in verse 7, he said, let her rest in the house. Now, whenever, of course, time came for her to rest, he had a place provided. Let her rest in the house. There's a time when you need to rest. Jesus said to his disciples, come apart and rest a while. Now, if you don't come apart and rest a while, you will come apart. Now, God intended for man to have a day of rest. That's why he said labor 6 days and rest on the seventh day, and rest 1 day out of seven, and that you need to do. No man can go 7 days a week without some day folding up and his body breaking in some part because of overlabor and overwork. You need to rest. You need to rest and let God Almighty rest your body at least a day a week, and then worship God. Now, some people work 7 days a week. I contend you'll never gain anything by it. You'll eventually break your health. You're going to lose money by laboring 7 days a week in the long run. You mark my word. You may think you're making money by laboring 7 days a week, but you're not. You're going to lose money. That's a principle that you cannot erase. Eventually, you're going to lose more than you ever earned on that seventh day. Israel found that out when they were carried into Babylon and had remained there for 70 years. They had to remain there each year that they violated the Sabbath. So you must remember that you cannot gain nor get by nor prosper by laboring 7 days a week. You let God have that day. You honor the Lord. Or you say, preacher, I think what I'll do, I'll just go fishing on Sunday. Yes, you'll have to catch the devil too. Now just remember that you can get into trouble by laboring 7 days a week and not giving God at least a day of rest for your body, giving yourself that time and worshiping God. And so we find, he said, rest in the house. And then he wanted her to abide by the maidens. Abide by the maidens, verse 8. Now he wanted her to remain by the maidens, the only women there in the field. That was the best association for her. She could associate with them, and they could tell her about some of the experiences. And she was completely safe, resting, abiding there by the maidens. It's always good, dear soul, always good to abide with God's people. God doesn't want his children running around, hobnobbing around every tall baby in the world. God wants you to associate with his people, to love his people, to fellowship with his people. They're the greatest people in the world. As a child of God, they're the ones you need to associate with, commune with, fellowship with, pray with, worship with, because they're God's people, and you're in God's family, and that's what you need to do, is to associate with the people of God. There's been a lot of people that had a good testimony, but they started running around with this world. You can't do that. You lay down with the dogs, you're going to get up with fleas on you. You run out here with the world, you're going to grow cold and indifferent. Now you need to associate with God's people. Stay in church as often as you can. Stay in prayer meetings, in fellowship, and in fellowship with the people of God. That you need to do as a child of God. Many of a child of God is backslidden on the Lord because they start running around with some worldly person, some unsaved person. You can't do that. You need to associate with the people of God. So he said, now, I want you to stay by my maidens. That he intended for her to do. Stay away from anyone else in the field. Stay by the maidens. So you need to stay by those that can benefit you spiritually and associate with you. The Bible speaks about the elder women teaching the younger. Now, Ruth could learn some things from these elderly women here that's gleaning in this field if she's willing to listen and associate with them and let her fellowship be with them. She can learn a few things, and so it is with you. I wonder today, are you really associating with God's people? If not, then you ought to find the people of God and associate with them. They're the ones, they're the people God wants you to associate with. Now, if you're not saved, you need to get saved. Turn to Jesus Christ, because you never know when it can or will be too late. So you need to turn to God. I trust you will. And so may God bless you as you endeavor to do so.